welcome to the first ever Latinx Kidlit Book Festival. I am Anika Aldamuy Denise. I'm the author of fiction and nonfiction picture books, including A Girl Named Rosita and Planting Stories, The Life of Librarian and Storyteller Pura Belpré. I'm also a huge fan of the two guests we will be speaking with today, the amazing award-winning author Julia Alvarez and acclaimed award-winning illustrator Raúl Colón. Before we begin, I want to quickly remind everyone to please read our anti-harassment policy in the chat box. And to let you know that our discussion today will be centered around Julia and Raúl's gorgeous new picture book, Already a Butterfly, a meditation story, and Julia's work with the Mariposa Foundation. And we want to hear all about how Raúl created the artwork, the gorgeous artwork for this book. So I'm going to do really quick introductions because I know we want to get to all our questions. Julia Alvarez is the author of numerous best-selling and award-winning novels, including How the Garcia Girls Lost Their Accents in the Time of Butterflies, Yo, Return to Sender, the Tia Lola series, Afterlife, as well as collections of poems, works of nonfiction, and picture books. Raúl has illustrated several highly acclaimed picture books, including Draw, the New York Times best-selling Angela and the Baby Jesus by Frank McCourt, Susanna Reich's Jose, Born to Dance, and Jill Biden's Don't Forget, God Bless Our Troops. Welcome, Julia and Raúl.
Gracias.
Hello. Thank you. Gracias.
So I want to dig right into my first question. This is the story of Mariposa, the butterfly, who's always busy flitting here and there, and she's not always like present. And she's helped to discover mindfulness. So I know, Julia, this was inspired by your practice of meditation. Can you tell us a little bit about that practice and how you came to it?
Well, I think I came to it, you know, in a way, drawn into it by friends that are meditators. And I was going through a very difficult time in my life. A lot of losses and deaths. You know, one of the things about coming from a Latina familia is that it's huge, it's a clan, and it's great. But when you start losing a generation, you don't just lose a nuclear few, you lose dozens of tías, tíos, older cousins, your parents. And it just felt like I was just needing to get grounded. And so I started my meditation practice. And at first I didn't think it was that strange from what I'd done before, because I think when I write, it's a form of meditation as well, of losing yourself in the moments that you're writing about. So the meditation practice, I've now been doing it about 15 years, early in the morning and at night at the close of the day. And it's really helped me.
I was thinking about what you said with writing as a meditation. I want to throw that over to you, Raúl. Do you find that drawing? Because for me, when I'm thinking, I'm doodling a lot of times, even though I'm not an illustrator. So is drawing kind of a form of meditation for you?
I think it is for everybody. You get lost in it. So you go into another world. It's like reading, per se, when you get into reading and you disappear into a completely different world. And it's a form of meditation. Many times when I'm busy working, I can disappear for a period of time, which when I get a phone call, for instance, to wake me up from it, right? Wake me up again from it, come out of that world. I don't know how I did what I was doing. Wow. I can't remember because I was somewhere else. So it's like meditating. You go into some subconscious world that you didn't know about, and you are not thinking about the present. You're somewhere else.
And they say that's how you know you're doing the right thing, that you're doing something you love, is when you lose time doing it, right? So that's very cool. So just to stay on the artwork for a minute, How did you approach creating the illustrations, in particular the character of Mari, because she's fairy-like, you know, she's anthropomorphic, and I wondered, was there a discussion? How did you come to that choice to approach her character that way, as opposed to maybe something more naturalistic? I mean, I love her. I connect with her.
Yeah. Well, I did think about that. I thought of doing a kind of a cartoony insect, cute cartoon, that kind of thing that looked like a butterfly. But I realized that the way it was written, right, by Julia, this character had all these human feelings, basically, right? So I had to think that maybe I had to humanize it a little bit. I wanted to put some expressions on her face. So I decided to make her more like a little girl that you would see anywhere. And Julia was very nice to send photos of many of her visits. So I was looking through the photos and I said, well, those girls that are dressed like butterflies themselves, remember? You sent some pictures, Julia. That's what I should go after, something like that. So I kind of based it a composite of all these young girls I saw in the photos. And I said, that should be the character. And I made a composite of all of them until I got a face and character I think worked for what I wanted. And I made her into a young girl. And that's how it worked for me. And it was approved.
Yeah, Anika, I sent Raúl, the little girls, or the girls that I sent pictures of are the Mariposa Foundation from the DR, which is a foundation for street girls that would otherwise not get an education, 8 to 18. And the American woman that started the organization called it Mariposa Foundation because she had read in the Time of the Butterflies about the Dominican heroines. So I sent the photos to Raúl to show them to show him, you know, what the look of these kids was like, because the book was written specifically for them. So it was wonderful because Raúl took it and he took it to another level. Talking about meditation, I look at the artwork in this book and it is a meditation. I can get lost in the pictures. They are so, you know, they're so otherworldly. The colors, the expressions, like you say, it's just wonderful. I really feel privileged, Saul, and honored that you took this on. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
I agree that the artwork was really beautiful. And I read it with my daughter. And I did notice as I was reading it to her that a calmness came over her. And especially when we got to the character of Bud, who I love. And he does actually, you know, make the sound. He said, and so we did it together and she did it with me. And she actually commented on how that made her feel calm and peaceful. So I think that if that was the intention of the book, which I imagine that it is, that it really worked. And my daughter's 8 years old and constantly on the move. She reminds me of Mari. So I really, you know, she connected to it as a young reader. Can you tell me, Julia, a little bit about what that was like when you introduced meditation to the Mariposa Foundation and how it transformed them in what ways? Like, I think it's truly an amazing thing to teach any young people. What was that like?
Well, you know, I've been with the Mariposa Foundation from the start. Of course, I feel like the madrina because of its origin. But I was noticing these girls were getting an amazing set of skills, a way to escape out of the generational cycles of poverty. But the skills to sort of integrate all this information and new stimuli, and no one at home that had ever been through this. I mean, many of their parents couldn't read or write, and they were earning scholarships even to American colleges. But you know, there was so much going on and no centering skills. So it was a way to sort of get them grounded and teach them self-control and focus and not losing your way as you go forward because everything is so new and tempting and distracted. You say, how has it transformed them? I'm not sure that that's what meditation does. Mm. Although I think meditation teachers say, don't, you know, after each session, don't say, well, how was that? You know, am I any better? It's a process, you know, it's, and you're never supposed to succeed. Each time your mind strays, you bring it back to your breath. So you're developing the ability to focus, the process of focusing. And the distractions are part of building those muscles, you know. And so I think over time, they said, don't look at what each session brings, but over time you will see the results, you know, and people will see it. So I think it's a process. And it's like, you know, what does running do? It helps keep you limber. It helps keep you healthy. This is a form of psychic and emotional and health. And I think it's just something that's ongoing. It's a practice. You don't stop running and say, well, I got that under my belt. It's an ongoing practice. Like writing, like art. I mean, Raúl, if you said, well, you know, I've done that project. Next time another one comes, I'll pick up my pen. No, it's the ongoing habit of practicing the crafts we love, you know, and this is important.
I love that. I think that that's something really, especially for kids, because when they first begin meditation, they, and I think adults too, they feel like, okay, I'm not doing it right. And so you're encouraging them to sort of let go of that. And that happens to Mari in the book as well. You know, Bud says, bring your mind back, you know? And so I think that that's something that I think kids reading the book will take away from it. What do you hope kids reading the book will take away from it? That's to Julia.
Well, I think one of the things that I wanted for Mari is, the things she needs are already inside her, you know, there's nothing wrong with her. There's nothing she has to do, you know, there's just connecting with what she already is. And that is our job in life, you know, to fully realize who we are. And I want kids, first of all, to slow down. I see so many of my friends, grandkids, so overscheduled, so many things to do, so many stimuli. The internet itself is constantly bombarding them with things. And I think it's a way to settle down and connect with, you know, the things that are already inside you and who you really are, rather than achievements or activities or stimuli. And that's something that I think is really endangered right now, you know, with so much going on and the internet, a wonderful tool, but it has its place. Yeah.
Yeah. And I think before the pandemic, before, you know, we were all, of course, adults and children, overscheduled, always doing. And then after the pandemic, things did contract a little bit and we had to learn how to let go of some of our schedules. But then an anxiety comes in and you talk about that too. Like the pandemic has brought us, it's done a lot of, like, switched things up on us so much. But I think that quieting your mind too is something that feels like could be a wonderful takeaway for children who right now might feel nervous and, you know, not and unsure with school being different. There's so much change has come in such a short time. So I think that's a really beautiful thing about reading this book and something that even as I read it as an adult reader, really took from it. Okay, I'm gonna throw it back to Raúl. We're talking about meditation and being calm. And then I thought about when you were working on this book all about mindfulness and meditation, was there things that were challenging? And what was the most challenging? And was that funny to be working on a book about meditation and never get frustrated?
Yeah, it was challenging actually because you want it to be interesting. So it's a heavy theme, really. You have, you know, meditation in a picture book. How do I? But in reality, the way Julia wrote it, you could see a story. So I focused on the story of the young butterfly and how she felt about things and her surroundings. So I said, okay, so I'll try to focus on all the visual and the colors and all that that make her whirl. And that way I could come up with concrete piece of work where children could see visually what the story was about, even though meditation is a more abstract kind of idea, right? So her world was what I was focusing on, her surroundings and how to make that work. I realized that I was gonna use a lot of color. Mm-hmm. I didn't want to make it too insect-like, you know, too realistic. So they'd see a kind of a different world, something they're used to. They see, you know, the world out there, the insects and all that, and leaves and trees. But I also wanted to stylize it, give it some color, and sometimes condense the colors into different shapes, going from blues to greens to yellows to, you know, that kind of thing. And that's what I did. The environment around her made the visuals work. And having her flying around and all that was good too, you know, and those big wings and all that. And by the way, I had to do some research. I had to look at a bunch of butterflies. I went over every butterfly I could look at and figure out which colors I wanted to use and that kind of thing. I also did not want to make a specific butterfly. So, because he was going to be a problem. I draw a specific butterfly, right? And somebody, and I put some flowers in there or whatever, and somebody was going to call, because this all happens all the time, and say, ah, those butterflies and those flowers don't go together. They don't exist in the same country, or, you know, you get that kind of thing. So I said, let me leave it a little free, you know, give it some freedom, that it's a butterfly, looks like a butterfly, and then I can incorporate whatever kinds of flowers or vegetation. And by the way, Julia had a list of flowers that she quotes in the book. So that's what I also tried to do, and I guess it worked out.
Yes.
So all that helped with the visual.
It's gorgeous.
Then that was a challenge.
Well, part of what body learns is to pay attention to the central world around her. So by creating this really just palpable, beautiful, sensual, dreamy world, the reader's eye too is invited to, you know, to be present to the art. So I think that's, it worked beautifully. The other thing is, you know, yoga, meditation, it's sort of like a white population reputation that it has. And I really, really appreciated Raúl making Mari, like the mariposas in the DR, a little girl of color, you know, because this is, meditation is not, you know, it's not color segregated that way. It is part of a skill we all have to learn about staying focused and not, you know, getting so distracted and overwhelmed. So I really love her beautiful, rich brown color. She's wonderful. So I like, not that, oh yes, that's one of my favorites. Yes.
It sounds like it was very collaborative in that you shared research with each other. And is that how you always work with your author or illustrator? Was this a unique experience? And either one of you to answer that one.
I can answer, no. This is not normal. Usually the author and the illustrator, and we haven't met actually live at least. So that's first time we meet here. Hey. Usually the author and illustrator are separate. You know, the editors keep us away from each other. I guess there was a reason for that, and I've heard the stories. But they want each person to have their own creative freedom. So we work that way, separate from the author. So many times I've finished books and I never met the author. I never had any input from the author. I just had the story and the text. So this one was a little different because I did receive a lot of help from Julia, but which she sent these to the editor and then she would pass them on to me. And then some were sent to me, you know, some of the photographs and research she had done herself. So all of that helped put it all together. And we didn't really call each other on the phone or anything like that and talk long talks of how we were going to put it together. But it was a little different in that sense that I did receive a lot of material that I could use and suggestions on not the story itself, but on to look at these butterflies or look at this other reference. And that helped me put it all together. So in that sense, it was very different. I've done other books where I just look for the reference myself. I do everything myself. And I just put drawings out and actually the sketches out. And if they're approved, good. And I go forward. And then years later, I meet the author. So this is great.
Yeah, I've never had... the book that I did before this, I think you might see it here, Where Do They Go, which is a book that I wrote after losing my sister, and I was for years mourning and very unable to move forward. And there was an artist, Sabra Feel, she's an older Vermont printmaker, and her art is up at the college, Middlebury College. And what I found during the time of mourning is there were certain, I couldn't read just any old book. It had to be a certain kind of book. The older, the better. So I read Gilgamesh over and over. Don't ask me why. Certain music was all I could bear, and only certain art. And when I went to the library, I saw her art on the wall, and I would go pretty much several times a week and just sit and look at it. She has a series called the Demeter Persephone series, and I just would sit there and feel solace. So when this book finally came, the poem, it was a poem, I actually had the gumption of finding Sabra Fields and asking her if she would consider. And she said, well, send me what you have. And she had just lost her husband suddenly. So she was in mourning too. So we made a connection that had to do with two women grieving, really. So that was the, and otherwise it's been what Raúl says. I don't know the illustrator. I've never met the illustrator. You know, it's just, and I sort of see that and like that because it means I don't want the art to be subservient to the text or the text to the art. It has to be, you know, each one has its own wings. And I think that's really wise.
I agree with that. So being someone who works on picture books too, I always am mindful of stepping in too far, and I'm married to an illustrator, so I know better than to put a lot of art notes. Right? That will no art notes, like unless it's absolutely essential.
Has he illustrated any of your books, Anika?
We have partnered on four picture books. My first books were actually with my husband Christopher, and so I have seen it both ways then, where it's been very collaborative because I can walk out to his studio and kind of, you know, be a pain and probably get in the way and assert myself more than I should as the author. But typically I do think that it is nice to kind of let each other, you know, do what you do. And clearly in this case, it just came out so beautifully. I think this is really just, it's one of my favorite books, and not only because I'm coming here, but it's one of my favorite books that I've read this year. I know I was coming to interview you. And then I had already seen it. It was at my local indie bookshop. I'm gonna give them a little shout out. That's Barrington Books. And it really, it drew me to it. So I'm wondering if you guys will pair up again.
Oh my gosh. Raúl, he's the best. And his own books, you know. And I found out, I mean, I knew about Raúl, of course, his name is out there. But Pat Mora is a dear friend of mine. And some of the books you did for her, I felt artist envy. I want him to do my books, you know. It's just, so I got my wish. Some good things have come out of the pandemic here.
Thank you. Yeah, so Anika and I will have to
work out.
Yeah, I get dibs.
Raúl, I mean, who will not love Anika, who's written a book about Pura Belpré? I mean, I know you've gotten the award. I've gotten the award when nobody paid attention to us, and we had our own little corner. You know, the Pura Belpré awards. Thank God for them. You know, recognizing us. So to write her story down is just an amazing contribution to people getting to know her, you know.
Thank you. It was a journey. I loved getting, I mean, you know, I knew Pura stories growing up, but I loved the journey of getting to know her as well. So well, that's excellent segue into another question of mine about your writing process, Julia. Do you do an extensive amount of research? And I'm talking about when you're writing novels or middle grade, or are you a go from the gut, write, and then go back and fill it in?
No, I am. I'm a researcher. You know, I believe in what William James has advised to young writers: be him, and I add her, and they, on whom nothing is lost. So part of your job as a writer, as I tell kids, it's not when you sit down, it's paying attention. You know, Lorca said that the poet is the professor of the five senses. You have to be awake and pay attention. So it's even as silly as sometimes I have a character walking through a grocery store. And like Raúl said earlier, you know, if he puts in a certain kind of butterfly and a certain flower and they don't belong together, he's gonna hear about it. So I'll go to the grocery store and I'll make notes. What, you know, is what is next to the cereal? You know, what is stocked next to what? What are some of the names? What are some of the cool names you figure out? And, you know, it might be something that you never see as the reader, or you just see when the character reaches for a box, what's next to it. But I've gone through the trouble of driving to the grocery store and doing the research. And it's a way of, I just am a curious person, and it's a way to pay attention. So yeah, I the problem is research could sometimes be too much fun and go on forever.
I'm a big research nerd. I love it. And I go down many a rabbit hole when I'm doing that. And I'm like, I really should be writing, but I'm still researching. And I think there's joy in that. And I kind of embrace that. But something that you said, I love it. You know, you have to be awake and pay attention. And that just ties in so beautifully to this book, because it's all about training your mind to be awake and pay attention. And there's this part in Already a Butterfly where she really comes awake and starts noticing things more. And I think that's one of the beauties of a meditation practice, which I came to later, much later in my life. But it certainly has helped me as a writer notice things and write more lushly and with more detail. So for those young writers out there, this is like masterclass with Julia and Raúl right now. Your curiosity, I think, is one of your best tools, right?
Yeah, exactly.
So Raúl, what are you curious about, and what are you working on next? Can you Can you talk about it? Has it been announced?
Well, I'm working on, hasn't been announced, but I am working on a book with Margarita Engel and about immigration, especially from the point of view of children. So that's what I was working on. And what I'm curious about, you asked me, right? So I'm curious about what I'm going to do next year with all that happened this year. if I'll come up with, I'm trying to write one more story because I had a couple of books, wordless picture books I wrote. And I had a third one in there somewhere. So that's one. And I'll try to, next year, I think I'm going to go for it and finish that third one. And it may not be wordless, we'll see. But that's one thing I'm curious about finishing. And one thing that it's important to tell the young writers and artists, I don't only do picture books, I'm also interested in music. Mm-hmm. So I'm doing some of that too. A lot of artists I know do the same. They're musicians, frustrated musicians, or whatever you want to call it. But we also do other activities that help and informs what we do with the art. I watch a lot of movies. I'm a big movie buff. All that stuff informs the art. So I'm curious about a lot of those things. And I'm always trying to see the newest, greatest movie ever made coming up somewhere in the future. So that's what I try to do.
I love that. I think that is so true about artists and writers. They usually have another passion or another way that their creativity comes out. Either they're sewing or they're musicians or one of my really good, like most accomplished writer friends that can finish a novel so fast and it's a brilliant, and I can't understand how she does it. Also is a ballerina. And when she's wants to just be free, she straps on her shoes and she just dances. And so I think that's a really fun thing. And I think it's interesting for kids to know that the creativity doesn't come out in just one way, right? And it usually feeds one art form feeds another. So I'm gonna then transition this to Julia. What is your other things that you love to do that are creative?
Well, Raul, I wanted to be an artist. Oh, but unfortunately, it didn't go that way.
You are an artist.
they put me in an art class when I was a young girl, and it was this art teacher, very strict in the Dominican Republic. It was almost military. We had to do calisthenics with our hands. And then we could only draw a pair over and over and over and over again. Over and over and over. It was just, she was very European trained. And she kind of dismissed our, island art as kind of garish and not, she was pretentious. And so, when she wasn't looking, I'd start drawing butterflies, rainbows, crazy stuff. And I was sent home and my mother was told that Julia isn't ready to be an artist. But I still love doodling and making pictures.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. Now is the time to do it.
And, music is in our blood. Right? Music is in our blood. And I just dancing and putting on merengue, bachata, moving around. Yes. So I would have loved to have been maybe not a ballerina, but a dancer like Rita.
Yes.
Yeah. Show us your book.
This is the Spanish version. It is also available in Spanish. Yeah, that's my other passion. I love musical theater. I was trying to think for the flip grids. I was trying to think of three things, like weird facts about me, and is that I know the words to a lot of show tunes was mine because because I grew up in New York City and my mom took us to a lot of plays. We didn't have the money to go to Broadway shows, but she figured out that she could go to see it in preview. And so she got on a mailing list. I think it was TKTS. You know how you can get those tickets in Manhattan now? She got on that mailing list and you could check the box if you wanted to go see, you know, Peter Pan or Into the Woods, or, you know, before it was actually out, and you could go really cheaply. So we used to take the subway in on a Wednesday evening and see shows in preview. So that's my other, I can't really sing all that well, but I would pretend to into my hairbrush, you know? So that's my weird other passion. And I think if I could do one other job, I would love to like do something in live musical theater. Probably behind the scenes.
That they're asking.
No time.
Oh, it's time to ask questions. Time.
Can you see the chat? Okay. Yes, I can.
Yeah, so there's still time for you to do that.
Yeah, that's my next act.
Musical theater.
So you're getting the band back together. Julia is going to be painting and drawing up a storm, and I'm going to go to Broadway when it reopens. Okay, so now it is time for some student questions. And we have our first question is from Sienna M. She is in second grade and in California.
Hi, my name is Sienna. My question is, how long does it usually take you to write a book?
Oh dear. I can never tell how long. Sometimes it comes quickly as where do they go? And even already a butterfly, because I had lived the story in a sense, you know, but sometimes it takes lots and lots of revision. And that's the thing about losing yourself in your work. You surrender to the story and the characters. And sometimes they come easily and sometimes they don't. So I can maybe get a book done in a few months, you know, a story written. And sometimes it takes my last adult novel before the one I published this spring, Afterlife, was almost 15 years before I went back to. But I've been working all along. You work, you know, you keep like a dancer, you keep limber, but sometimes books take longer. So Sienna, you never can tell, and that's part of the excitement. It's always a surprise to you too.
I love that. That I learned something in that question too, because I'm always curious how long it takes for different people's process. So that was a great question, Sienna. Okay, we have another question, yes? This one is from Taylor B. in fifth grade in Colorado.
Hi, my name is Taylor, and I love to write books. I was wondering, what inspires you to write?
Oh, Taylor, that's a great question. And I love meeting young writers. Can't wait till you get your book done. I hope it doesn't take you 15 years to get the first one out. What inspires me? You know, I feel like life, when you're open to it and paying attention, just fills up your heart. It's just full. And I think of my writing as what spills over. I can't hold it in. It's filled to the brim and then it spills over. Another way that I also explain it is, it's a pebble in my shoe. Something happens, like I was thinking of Margarita Engel. You know, I see the faces of those kids at the border, you know, looking up in terror, being wrenched from their parents. And it puts, we have a wonderful word in Spanish, an inquietud. A pebble in my shoe. And the only way, it just keeps rattling in there. And I said, no, I don't want to write a book about it. That's enough. Go away. You know, I'll shake it, but I can't shake it out until I shake it out on paper. So it's two metaphors of how I come, what inspires me to write. an inquietud, and just a, like, my heart's gonna burst. And it's just full and spills on the paper.
That's the nicest and most poetic answer to that question. That is why you are Julia Alvarez. Okay, we have one more question, I believe, a third question. Okay, this is for Raúl. Did you draw a lot when you were a kid? And this is from Beck H., third grade in New Hampshire.
Well, yes, I did. A lot. Yes, I did. And one of the reasons was because when I was, I can't remember when I started. So I think that happens to all the children. Most, when I visit schools, children tell me they've been drawing since they can remember. So you start drawing. However, I never stopped. That was the difference. But as a child, I was very sick. I had something called, well, they call it chronic asthma, but I had it bad. I would be out of school. I couldn't go to school for maybe weeks on end sometimes. So I would miss a lot of school. Wasn't fun. Wasn't because I was out there partying. But while I was home and I felt better, all those days that I was out of school, I would just grab my notebooks and start drawing, keep drawing, go on drawing, buy comic books, keep drawing from the comic books, watch movies on TV, try to draw what I just saw on TV, and I would just fill up these notebooks. So I was drawing all the time with my, I only had a pencil, you know. I didn't have colored pencils or anything like that, maybe crayons once in a while in those days. And so I just filled these notebooks, you know, my composition notebooks. They weren't even drawing pads or anything like that. They were actual notebooks from school. Fill them up and I'd run out of notebooks. I would actually try to make a deal with my sister, my older sister. So she would give me her notebooks that she wasn't using. So I'd fill those up too. So my mom had to buy a lot of notebooks, but I spent hours on end. I didn't have video games or anything like that. I watched TV a little bit, but you know, that was not a big deal for me. Drawing was a big deal. So I spent many hours drawing. And as I got older and I went through magazines and saw other books, my sister's books, I would look through those because they were a lot more interesting to me than the ones I had in school. She was 4 years older. So I would get the great books and they had some great illustrators in the stories. So when I looked at her books, I saw that the illustrations were really good. And I would try to draw those too. And by the way, that led me into reading her books. So while I was maybe in second grade, I was reading sixth grade books. So that was what I did the whole time. And it worked out perfectly because as I grew up, it became a habit and I kept drawing till I got to where I am today.
You know, one thing I wanna, sorry to make this intrusion, but one of the things that I wanna point out to kids and parents watching this is that sometimes when a kid is given a rough situation, an illness or something happens, that, you know, a friend of mine once told me out of the word emergency comes emerge, that sometimes it's that very thing that leads you to the thing you love. So I think it's a wonderful story, Raúl, very moving. And I hope you write your story. That what a story that will be. Your story of becoming Raúl Colón. That's inspirational.
Yeah. Actually, the book Draw is based a little bit on that, on the fact that there's this little boy in his room and he starts drawing animals. So it kind of takes a little of what happened to me as a child. And I did include in one of the illustrations and draw medicine and stuff that you take when you have asthma,
oh, wow,
like inhalers. I put a little inhaler in there somewhere.
Oh my God, look at it.
Yeah. So the kids, some of the kids know exactly what it is. I know what that is.
Yeah.
Well, the boy was in his room because he wasn't feeling well, but he could draw. So yeah, I did incorporate that a little bit. And it's not the total story, but it, I put a few of those things that happened to me as a kid into it.
Wow.
By the way, other artists have gone through this too, like you said, Julia. A lot of, I know artists, illustrators who were also sick. Somebody couldn't walk for a while and was in the house. And, you know, they just dedicated themselves to drawing or painting or reading. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people have gone through similar experiences. And I think one of the most famous ones is Stephen King, who I think was, as a child, very sickly. Wow. Couldn't walk, I think, for a while. And so he wrote.
Wow.
And became a great writer.
Okay, I'm going to move us along. I love this theme, though, that's emerging, sort of like out of loss or out of illness. You know, you take your broken heart and you turn it into art. So we have one more question. And this is, how does being a part of such an important time in history, Trujillo, affect you and the stories you write? From Ileana R., fifth grade in Maryland.
Gracias, Ileana. That's a great question. And in honor of the Mariposas, the Mirabar sisters who started the underground against the dictator. And they were definitely an inspiration to me. I think we just sort of answered the question. It's not just personal tragedies, but you live a difficult time, a scary time, a terrifying time, a challenging time, and that inspires you. You know, you need to process it. You need to make sense of it. And one of the ways you do that is through art. I mean, it's the most important way, I think, to do it. So I think very much the dictatorship and the fears and the tensions inspired me to want to understand what had happened to us. And by the way, if we think that only happened in the past or it only happens in a dictatorship, we are living a moment that will need all you artists out there, writers, painters, musicians, dancers, to help us understand what this has meant to us as a human family. So we're living history all the time. And if we pay attention, it will get in us and we will write about it, do art, music, dance about it.
That is a really wonderful place to end, I think. Thank you so much for that. And I hope that everyone has taken that last message that you both left us with to heart, because it's a really important one. So I think that we are wrapping it up. Am I correct? They will tell me in the chat if I'm not, but I want to say a huge, huge thank you to Julia and Raul for your time, for your beautiful answers. I learned a lot. I know that the kids and educators out there enjoyed it. And also just want to say thank you so much to the Las Musas and the Latinx Kidlit Book Festival for holding this space for us together. It's been amazing. Thank you so much. And let's everybody hold up their books.
And Anika, thank you, my dear.
Oh,
you are generous, cariñosa, and you are all our children so that they can be together.
Right here, wave them around. Woo, jazz hands.